start with your proper session that will brew in thermodynamics.
Okay. Can I heat some water? Okay, so before starting this thermodynamics, heat and thermodynamics session, let me ask a question. Why mercury is used in mercury thermometers?
Mercury, one, it doesn't stick to the walls like water.
Okay.
Secondly, mercury expands in a more linear way than water would in a thermometer.
Okay.
Also, it has a high boiling point and a relatively...
Which is the most important thing? Out of the 3-4 things that you told, which is the most important?
Linear expansion.
Linear expansion, okay. It expands uniformly with temperature. Yeah.
Mercury is a pink, so it's visible.
It makes visible, okay. Why mercury is preferred in mercury thermometers? Perhaps since the answer is, some of the answers are given and you also wanted to give the same answer, therefore we are not, not answering. Alpha does not change. With temperature, very good.
Volume expansion is
low and uniform. Okay. Bol diya. Udhar kuch hai.
It does not stick to the walls of the mercury.
All right. It doesn't stick. Why? ठीक है. फॉल्ड से पहले उतारेंगे. It doesn't stick to the walls. Fine. Very good. Okay, now the important thing which is it has a uniform expansion, linear expansion, alpha is constant, that is the most important physics part. Other things we can manage. If it is not clearly visible, perhaps we can focus more on that, we can take a hand lens, etc., etc. Things can be managed. But the most important part to define a temperature scale through that thermometer, that okay, if mercury goes up to this point, it is 57, it goes up to that point, it is 58. Is that mercury expands uniformly with temperature. But how do you know that? Because you have defined your temperature scale by that thermometer only. Okay? So you have a thermometer and you say that if mercury is up to here, it is 50. If the mercury is here, it is 60. If the mercury is here, it is 65. So you have made the graduations in that fashion. Right? You have defined 50, 60, 70, assuming that 5 millimeter will be 10 degrees, 5 millimeter will be 10 degrees, 5 millimeter will be 10 degrees. So naturally it has to be uniform. You have to find it that way. Even if I don't take mercury, I take something else. Something else. Which according to you is non-uniform expansion and non-uniform alpha and all that. But I do the same thing. If that liquid goes up to here, I put a mark 50. Okay. And then 5 millimeters more I put 60. 5 millimeter more, I put 60, 70, and so on. And then I say, look, I increase the temperature by 10 degrees, and all the time it goes by 5 millimeters. So the alpha is constant. That you can say for anything. How do you say that mercury expands uniformly, and that is why we put mercury in the thermometer? Is there a problem? Is the problem clear? Why I am putting this question?
The problem is even book says that some of the.
Oh. The problem is with the books.
Then also
The problem is with the books. All right. You understand the question first, that's the thing. Although this is not a good question, do you understand it or not? What I say is, you are defining the scale by the expansion of the mercury. Okay. And on that same scale, you are saying that mercury expands in a uniform fashion, right? This is not proper. This is not proper. If you are defining a scale, assuming that it is uniform, it expands by 5 millimeters, and you say that the temperature has increased by 10 degrees. That is how you define your temperature, and then say that look, I increased the temperature by equal amounts, and see, it is going. Uniformly, so that's not proper, right? Huh? So that is the question. So instead of mercury, I put something else which you think it is non-uniform, and then there also it will be uniform. And on that thermometer, if I measure expansion coefficient of mercury, that will be non-uniform. On the mercury scale, if I measure the thermal, this volume expansion of that liquid, liquid A, that will be non-uniform. So which one to believe? Which of the two to believe? Thermometer, and then the two wires which are coming out, you have two different metals here, and then there is a junction. The junction goes inside the disc, and the other two free ends will go to multimeter. If the temperature of this junction is more than the temperature of surrounding, then you will see a potential difference here, a voltage appearing here, and that we will measure on the multimeter. Right? So if I connect the multimeter now, since the temperature is same as the room temperature, is this okay? Is the temperature of this disk same as the room temperature? You can touch and tell me. Well, let me bring this out, sir. The classics experiment. Which one is hotter of the two? कौन सा ज्यादा गर्म लग रहा है? ये ज्यादा गर्म लग रहा है, ये ठंडा लग रहा है ना? है क्या ऐसा?
कॉपर.
Which one is having more temperature of these two? This one is having more temperature. वो लग रहा है ज्यादा ठंडा लग रहा है लग रहा है, okay? So the copper one appears to be colder than the perspex one. This is colder, right? But then, yeah. But then the thermodynamics says that no, both are at the same temperature. Because they are in thermal equilibrium, use bigger words so that people understand that you know thermodynamics. So it is in thermal equilibrium with the room, and therefore according to the zeroth law of thermodynamics, blah, 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 the temperature of each one should be same as the temperature of the surrounding air, right? Okay. Yes.
Sir, copper is a good conductor.
Right. So both are having same temperature, same as the temperature of the surrounding air. Okay? But our hand is at a higher temperature. Our hand is a higher temperature because our body system is maintaining the body temperature much higher than what the room air is. Right? So when we touch, the heat goes from our hand to the disc. In each case, it goes to this copper disc if I touch this, it goes to perspex this disc if I touch this. But then because of the conductivity difference, the rate at which this heat is going from our hand to the disc is different. In case of copper, it's going faster because this copper disc is taking away the heat and therefore I have to supply more heat to bring it in thermal equilibrium with my hand. Right? And in case of perspex, it's only the surface which I have to heat up, not the this entire volume, because it's not transmitting the heat inside. And therefore, I feel that, okay, my hand doesn't have to give much of heat. So it looks slightly hotter as compared to this. That's it. Let's come back to our old question. Why do we say that mercury expands uniformly? Well, I have defined my temperature scale that way. Okay? And, okay, all right. Yeah, please answer.
Sir, this might be wrong, but in theory, if there is a system and suppose there is heat inflow into that system, that is positive X. Now, after that, you take a temperature reading. Now, that causes a certain increase in temperature and a certain expansion. Now, for the second time, if you cause again another inflow that is again of the magnitude X, and then you take the reading and the reading ratio to the expansion ratio is again same, then we can say that there has been a linear expansion. So we do not require a correct reading in this case, but only the same amount of heat inflow in both cases.
That is repeatability of your experiment, right, sir?
Yes.
That is repeatability. You have done your experiment well, so that when you repeat the experiment, you get the same result. See, I am saying that I have two liquids, A and B. I make two thermometers, okay? One with liquid A and one with liquid B. Okay. Now with thermometer A, that means the thermometer having liquid A, I measure the volume expansion of liquid A. I take in some vessel liquid A, put that thermometer A into that, heat it, and then I see that for equal expansion, I have equal temperature. Same thing I can do with B. I take liquid in B, in a vessel liquid B, I can take in vessel B, in a vessel liquid B, and put that thermometer B there. Thermometer having the liquid B there. And then I say that, okay, I'm heating, read temperature from here, volume expansion from here, and see it is uniform. But then if I swap, I use thermometer A to measure the volume expansion of B, liquid B. I say that, no, it is not expanding in uniform fashion. And if I take liquid B and put thermometer A, it is not expanding in uniform fashion. The two scales are different. The two scales defined by A and B are different. Right? On A scale, A is expanding uniformly. On B scale, B is expanding uniformly. And if you bring something C and measure the temperature of that liquid C with A thermometer and B thermometer, don't look for expansion. You just have it in beaker and you put and see what it is. For ice point, I have forced them to agree. Okay? At ice point, I have forced them to agree. I put zero there and I put zero there. At steam point, I have forced them to agree. That steam, there I have put 100 on this thermometer, 100 on that thermometer. But for an intermediate temperature. Something which is not boiling, water not boiling, water not freezing. Hot water, just like in our tumbler. The two thermometers will be different things. So the scale depends on the material. The temperature scale that we are defining in this fashion, by saying that is 0 degree and that is 100 degree, and then dividing it in equal 100 parts, putting graduations there, and then saying that yes, I have defined a scale. That scale depends on the material. And therefore, it's not a proper scale if it depends on material. And that is why in heat and thermodynamics, we look for a scale of temperature which is not dependent on the material you are using, which is an absolute scale. Right? So that's a need. And then you know how to define that absolute scale. Yes?
That absolute scale is Kelvin.
Yeah, we call it Kelvin. But how do I? First, why should I start to define that scale? And then the second, how do we achieve that?
You define that scale with taking zero as the point where all intermolecular activity ceases. And taking that as a starting point, you gradually move.
Very, 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 very difficult task to achieve. Very, very, I want to make a thermometer. And in asking me, first go to a system where all molecular activities have ceased. How do I get such a system to make my thermometer? In 1996 or so, some people could cool a small mass of gas, 2,000 atoms only, up to some nanokelvins, right? Few tens of nanokelvins, I believe. And they got Nobel Prize for that.
Who were the scientists, sir?
I don't remember, but you look for Nobel Prize in physics for Bose-Einstein condensation.
Yeah, Bose-Einstein, yes.
Okay? So that Nobel Prize was gotten because these people could cool the things to some 30-40 nanokelvin or so, where this Bose-Einstein condensation took place. That place transition took place. And they could implement or they could demonstrate the age-old theory of Satyendranath Bose and Albert Einstein, who had predicted through their equations that it should go to that particular phase at a low temperature. But it was achieved only recently. So going at that so-called zero Kelvin to make my thermometer is a very, very costly affair. Yes.
My take on this would be the need of standard, if you explain. It is defined by various standard conventions that 1 by 273.16 of the triple point of water is defined to be then Kelvin. So that we do not actually need to go to absolute zero to set the scale. Effectively, it means just that at the absolute zero, we will get zero Kelvin. That is how the scale has been defined.
So I think we use the scale defined by Mercury because that scale also satisfies the Charles law of gases.
Okay.
So one way we can check our scale is, so assume we follow the same experiment, we heat water to its boiling point. Okay. Let's mark that boiling point is 100 degrees Celsius, and then you put the same apparatus, you put the copper disc, we connect the copper disc to a multimeter. Now, assuming that the voltage, the potential difference at the ends vary linearly with temperature, when the voltage drops from 1 to 0.9, this much is the change in height. It drops from 0.9 to 0.8, this much is the change in height. 0.8 to 0.7, this much is the change in height. And if the drop in voltage, the ratio of the drop in voltage and the drop in height of mercury remains the same, then we can assume that it has a linear expansion, and then we can take the markings 100 to 0 degrees Celsius.
Yeah. So you are taking this thermocouple scale as a standard one, and against that you want to check that mercury scale. But unfortunately, I do not know, on the mercury scale, the thermocouple is highly nonlinear. The thermocouple scale is highly nonlinear. For 1 millivolt, how much is the temperature as measured by the mercury? For another next 1 millivolt,
how much is the temperature change as measured by the mercury, they are not equal. They are highly non-equilibrium, non-linear, and therefore we have to take a chart and read from that. Okay, 5 kilometer you go by auto, you pay something. 6 kilometer you go, you pay something else. 7 kilometer need not be linear relation, it's not proportional. Okay, so we do need a thermometer, a practical thermometer. So that practical thermometer, people have found from experience that if you can make a constant volume thermometer where pressure is related to temperature, you say that I will keep the volume of this gas fixed, and then as the pressure increases, correspondingly temperature increases, so equal change in pressure will be called equal change in temperature. So it is bound that it is independent of the material. You put hydrogen, you put helium, you put neon, anything, any gas you put, it is the same. Okay, and but it's not really the same. It varies slightly with how much gas you start with and how much volume. But if you make a dilute, take a dilute gas. Then it turns out that okay, it's independent of, almost independent, and then you make some kind of an extrapolation that as your dilution is very, very dilute, the density goes to almost zero, tends to zero, then the scale that would be defined by that turns out to be the absolute scale. And that scale, the fixed point which is given a value is that triple point. Okay? So how much is the temperature? Point 0.6 here and 0.09. Oh my god. How come? Part of it is exposed to air, that is creating problem. Which one is colder? Which one is colder here? So that is the first thing in heat and thermodynamics. If you are talking of heat and thermodynamics, you should have a thermometer, right? So we use mercury thermometer, resistance, platinum resistance thermometer. All these thermometers, we define scale, ice point, boiling point of steam point, and so on, and then we graduate, etc. But they are different from each other. And we cannot say that this is uniform, this is non-uniform, on this scale, this is uniform, on that scale, that is uniform, and so on. But then, for all thermodynamics, we define this absolute scale of temperature, where we say that triple point of water is 273.16 Kelvin, that number we have given. Why does that number? Why 273.16? Why not 300? Yeah, tell me.
So that it was created in such a way so that at the point where all the entropy of everything comes, you know, that point comes out to be zero.
But why that I have to define it. Why did I take such a peculiar number 273.16? Why not 200? Or why not 300? If I have to give a number. Okay, if I have to give it a number, why do we give such a weird number? Yes. I am defining the scale. I am defining the scale. I don't have a scale. I am defining the scale. So why at that particular temperature it has this property? It has a property. What is triple point, by the way? What is triple point?
And with solid liquid and gas.
There are answers. What can I do? What is triple point?
exist in all three
phases? Yes. The temperature at which all the three phases exist together in equilibrium. That means at that particular temperature, and remember, at a particular pressure also. At one atmospheric pressure, you will not be able to get any temperature at which water, vapor, and solid can coexist in equilibrium. Right? What is in equilibrium? That means water is not converting into vapor is not converting into water, ice is not converting into, so whatever amount I have kept is there. Right? You won't get any temperature. Right? So triple point is not only temperature, triple point is also pressure. Only when you have a particular pressure, in case of water it is something like 4.58 millimeter of mercury or so. Only at that pressure you get a situation in which you get a temperature in which the three things you put together and their contents will not change. They are in equilibrium. So that point is known as triple point. Fine. But to that, and then we say that our temperature will be proportional to the pressure of the gas. Now we have to get that proportionality constant, I have to give a value at one particular, y is equal to mx. For some x, I have to give some y so that m can be obtained. So we say that, okay, we take triple point of water and give it a value. So that will give me that proportionality constant. But that number is given as 273.16 Kelvin. This is to match with the traditional mercury thermometer temperatures. Okay? If I give it 200 Kelvin or 300 Kelvin or 400 Kelvin, then this scale, the readings on this scale and the readings of mercury scale will be very, very peculiar. There won't be a simple relation between these two. So we have chosen it so that from age-old times people are using mercury scale or platinum resistance scale. So they are not very scared about this new syllabus given by NCERT that you have to use Kelvin. And all our mercury thermometers are now to be thrown. So it's not like that. So by putting that number 273.16, we have ensured that Celsius scale is also usable. You only have to just put that number, you have to add that number to 273.15. Okay, so that is about the temperature scale. So I am trying to emphasize the need of an absolutist if we want to use thermodynamics. And all our PV equal to NRT, etc., is in that, on that scale. Fine.